specifically about the coming of the Lord. And what Paul says has to happen before the Lord comes. There's some things that precede the coming of the Lord. We're going to continue this conversation with the apostle today. And hopefully we will be challenged to think deeply, not only about the coming of Christ, but what is taking place right now in our lives. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, stand with me together if you would, beginning in verse number 1 and following. Now concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our being gathered together to Him, we ask you, brothers, not to be quickly shaken in mind or alarmed, either by a spirit or a spoken word or a letter seeming to be from us to the effect that the day of the Lord has already come. Let no one deceive you in any way, for that day will not come unless the rebellion comes first, and the man of lawlessness is revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalts himself against every so-called God or object of worship, so that he takes his place in his seat in the temple of God, proclaiming himself to be God. Do you not remember when I was with you that I told you these things? You know what is restraining him now, so that he may be revealed in his time. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who is now restraining it will do so until he is out of the way. And then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord Jesus will kill with the breath of his mouth and bring to nothing at the appearance of his coming. The coming of the lawless one is by the activity of Satan, with all power and false signs and wonders, and with all wicked deception for those who are perishing, because they refuse to love the truth and to be saved. Therefore, God sends them a strong delusion, so that they may believe what is false, in order that all may be condemned who do not believe the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. Would you pray with me? Lord God, we pray that you would open our eyes and our hearts to receive this word, that you will help us to take this word concerning the future and not only firmly believe that word, but to make application of it to our lives right now today. We thank you most of all for Jesus and that he died to set us free from our sins. It is in his name that we pray. Amen. You may be seated. We have already talked about being deceived. We have already introduced this man of sin, the son of perdition, who is called in the book of Revelation the beast from the abyss or the sea, who is referred to in 1 John and 2 John by the most familiar name that you and I use, and that is the Antichrist. As we talked about the last time we were gathered together on Wednesday night, because we take the passage that we have on Sunday morning and we go deeper into it on Sunday night and deeper into it on Wednesday night. And so on Wednesday night, one of the things that we started with was exactly what does Antichrist mean? And to go over that in summation, Antichrist or anti has two basic meanings in English. The primary meaning is that he is opposed to. Anti means opposed to. So he is the one opposed to the Christ. But it also has a secondary meaning. Anti means opposed to. Anti also means instead of. So not only is he one opposed to Christ, a feather or a dead leaf in the wind, and Christ, and he's gone. It's all over.
Yes.
It's all over. That is how powerful our Christ is. And it is important for us to remember that as we study such passages and such characters as the Antichrist. As a matter of fact, let's just read that last part, because I love this, verse number 8. And then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord Jesus will kill with the breath of his mouth. With the breath of his mouth. And bring to nothing by the appearance of his coming. Now, what is also important for me to note, before I get into the heart of what we're going to look at today, it is important for me to know that this is all taking place according to God's timetable. Did you get that? It says in verse number 6, and you know what is restraining him now, so that he may be revealed in his time. This is according to God's timetable. It is not that God is somehow or another pushed to the brink where all of a sudden he's got to show up on the planet and make everything right. Everything that is taking place is according to what God has said would happen on the day, the time, the month, and the year that God said it would take place. That's important for me to remember. Because lots of times when I'm out in the community and I'm talking to people or listening to people, and a lot of times I will overhear conversations that prove to be very interesting. I was to tell you about one just the other night. It was the last week, or maybe it was Monday night. I can't remember what night it was. I had run into the Dollar General here in Lugoff just to pick up a couple of items before I was on my way. And as I'm walking around, there's a lady that at first I don't recognize, but there's a lady, and she is on her cell phone there in the Dollar General. And she's on the cell phone. I don't need to listen in on her conversation, but she's in a public place talking in a normal voice. How can I not overhear what she's talking about? And to my amazement, she was talking about me. And you. She's telling whoever is on the other end of the line that she has just moved back into town after being gone for X number of years. I don't remember how long. And that she is planning on seeing if Pastor Chuck is still the pastor at Trinity. And she thinks I am. And she's going to drive up 34 to look at the sign, because this is where she wants to come to church to hear me preach. And I'm like, wow, what a shot, Mom. I walked out of Dollar General, and I'm telling you, they had to call the people that were working in the back to come up and open both doors to get me to go out. You know, it is not often you hear them say something good about you. You know, I have no idea why I told you that. It just really sounded good at the time to say. In this passage of Scripture, Satan's son, the Antichrist, is taken out by the breath of Jesus' mouth. That's how powerful Jesus is. He is not going to show up until God says it's time. That's where I was. A lot of times when I'm out in the community and people are talking to me, or I'm listening to other folks in conversation, I will hear some well-meaning believers say something along the lines of, you know, things are getting worse and worse and son of perdition. With that understanding, what Paul's telling us is that there is a restraining going on in the spiritual realm that we can't see. Now, this is how I know God is in control, because number one, that's what the Bible tells me, and that's what Paul's telling me here, because Paul says, until the thing that is restraining the spirit of Antichrist, the spirit of Antichrist cannot come to full fruition until what is restraining is moved out of the way. Notice how he says it. And you know what they knew we don't know. And you know what is restraining him, that is the man of sin, now, so that he may be revealed in his time. For the man, mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he, before he said what is restraining, now he says he, only he who now restrains it, that is the spirit of Antichrist, will do so until he is out of the way. Who is this one that is restraining the spirit of Antichrist? Well, throughout the age of the church, there have been a number of, by very good Bible scholars, great men of God, great women of God, there have been a number of personalities put forth that are said to fulfill who is restraining the Antichrist. Now, I'm going to give you all three of those in just a second. What I'm going to tell you is, on a personal level, I'm undecided, because I believe it's going to all come out the way God wants it to, regardless of what I think or what anybody else thinks anyway. But beyond that, as much as I have studied it, and I have studied it a great deal, I am still undecided. And that it's okay for me to be undecided, because God's going to work it out in his own time. And it's okay for me as a Bible student. It's okay for me as a pastor. It is okay for me as a believer to say, you know, I believe someone or something is restraining the spirit of Antichrist, whether I know who it is or not. Now the three major answers, there are some minor answers as well through the history of the church. The three major answers are that, first of all, the he is a what, and it is the rule of law, what you and I know as government. What we see in the book of Revelation is that this guy takes over the government. And then until that point, he is restrained by the rule of law. Now we recognize, now think about this, this is a legitimate answer. All these are legitimate answers, I believe, except one. And I understand this because I know what the Bible teaches me is that the when this guy, the Antichrist, gets to the point where he is taking over the government, the restraining effect is removed. Possible. There are others who say that the restrainer is the Holy Spirit. And we know from the Gospel of John that the Holy Spirit does have a restraining effect upon the pagan world. That the Holy Spirit doesn't just move among believers, but according to what Jesus said on the night before he was crucified, that the Holy Spirit does this restraining work in that he convicts the world of righteousness. What most of psychology and most of us refer to as people's conscience. The Bible doesn't know such language as people's conscience. What the Bible would say is that it is the Holy Spirit working in individuals whereby they know right from wrong, and it restrains them. And so, some commentators have said that the spirit of Antichrist is not going to be set loose on the world until the Holy Spirit is removed, taken out of the way. Here is the problem with that, and this is the one that I do have a great deal of problem, and I just simply don't believe it. Because in Revelation chapter 13, we read this on Wednesday night together, we read it on Sunday night together, the Bible says that the beast will make war on the saints and overcome them. Listen to me. No one can possibly be saved without the Holy Spirit of God. But the Bible says, Paul says it over and over again, if you do not have the Spirit of Christ, you are none of Christ. So I know that during the time period known as the Great Tribulation, when the Antichrist is present, there are going to be believers on the planet. And if the Holy Spirit is removed, there cannot be any believers. Therefore, that is the one explanation for this passage that I totally do not believe. But if you believe it, that's fine. There are great people, greater than I am, smarter than I am, who rather believe it. I just don't believe it. The third candidate, the third major candidate for who is restrained, and I have to do a little preface with this, is that according to the book of Daniel, and according to the book of Revelation, when war broke out in heaven, that the prince of Israel, the commander of the angel army of God, is in a personal struggle and battle with the spirit of Antichrist, who is none other than Satan himself. And that individual in Scripture mentioned three times, or four, something like that, is the archangel Michael. Now the preface I will give to that is that there are plenty of the founders of the Baptist movement and other evangelical movements, Charles Haddon Spurgeon, to name one, in recent memory of the founder of Southwestern Seminary, all taught that the Archangel Michael is none other than Jesus Christ himself by another name. So if that's the case, if the Archangel Michael is actually Jesus, then it's not Jesus that's removed. But if the Archangel Michael is not Jesus, then it's quite possible that he is the one on the spiritual realm who is restraining the Antichrist and is removed. For me, I have no idea. With all three of those things that I just gave you, I can give you arguments of why it is not that thing. So I don't know who it is, but I do know that there's someone or something that is restraining the Antichrist. And as I thought about that, and I prayed about that, and I prayed specifically about how do I make application of this to my Monday, the thing I was led to was to think a little bit about the contrast of this, the opposite of this, if you would. And that is the gospel, the message of the cross of Jesus Christ. Because you see, the gospel, though it does have some restraining abilities against sin, it does. The main point of the gospel of Jesus Christ is not restraining anything or anybody. It's about transforming people. Not restraining, but transforming. And that the gospel of Jesus Christ, the message that my sins are forgiven, the message that I have been made right with God, the message that I have been given, the gift of the Holy Spirit, the guarantee that I will be raised on the last day, that the gospel message transforms my life. I may not yet be all that I'm supposed to be, but I am surely not what I used to be.
Amen.
The gospel message transforms my life. The gospel message empowers my life that I might actually live for Jesus Christ on a day-by-day basis. That the gospel message transforms, that the gospel message empowers, and that the gospel message renews. You know, throughout the Old Testament, the prophets were always saying to the people of God, the message of God, return to me. Return to me. The word we use generally is repentance. But God, in the Old Testament in particular, seems to always be calling his own people that already belong to him back to himself. And when I look at my own life and my personal walk with God, what I realize is that there are times that I have been living for God, that I have been dedicated to God. There have been times in my life that I can pinpoint and say, you know, I know beyond a shadow of a doubt that no matter what was going on, I was sold out for Jesus. And then there have been other times in my life, and it wasn't necessarily because I had fallen into some gross sin, though that's possible. But instead, it was just the everydayness of life wearing on. You know, you're married now, you got kids, or you got grandkids, you get up, you go to work, just the everyday motions of life have a means without anything really bad taking place. And it's not that we become really bad, but the everyday motions and busyness of life have a way of getting a hold of our mind and our hearts in such a way that we can say, honestly, you know, I remember when I was so on fire for God. I remember when I was so passionate about Jesus. It's not that I don't love him. It's not that I don't pray. It's not that I don't read my Bible daily. But I've got to tell you that where I'm at right now is not where I've been before in relation to God. And so what I need to hear is that the gospel not only transforms and empowers, but the gospel also renews. That over and over again in my life, God has called me back to him. That sometimes it has been because I have fallen into some gross sin. But that most of the time it's just because I got busy with life and with living and with my daily activities. And first and foremost on my mind was not serving Jesus. It wasn't that it wasn't there. It just wasn't the top priority. I was just too busy with living. And fortunately, through some gospel preacher, I heard the message, return to me. Return to me. It wasn't that God wasn't worried about where I had been, but it was like he wasn't worried about where I had been. He was worried about me, and that's tongue-in-cheek, because we know been away a little while. Okay, so you've been away a long while. Okay, so you've been in really deep sin. Okay, so you've just been busy. God just wants you. God wants you back with Him. Because He's the only one that can transform. He's the only one that can empower. He's the only one that can renew. And in that transforming and empowering and renewing, sin is restraint. That does take place. But God's primary object is not in restraining our sin, though that is to be. His primary object is to retain us for His own love, for His own sake. He just wants us. Wants us. Wants you. So it may be that you are here this morning and you look at your life and you've really never been transformed. That you are the same as you used to be. Or maybe you really look at your life and you don't feel the power of God to live for you. Or maybe you look at your life and you know us beyond a shadow of a doubt that you were transformed and that you have known His power, but you need to be renewed. You need to be renewed because you find yourself in deep sin. You need to be renewed because you're just busy. And you become so busy and involved with life that Christ is not in first place. And right now, today, I can trust that whoever or whatever it is restraining the Antichrist until it's on God's timetable for him to be released. But I can know most of all that the message of the gospel is about transformation, not restraint. Would you pray with me? Lord God, we just come to You this morning recognizing the restraining power against sin, against satanic forces of evil that exist, that You have put in place, even in our own life. We thank You for that. But most of all, we thank You for the transforming power of the gospel that changes our lives, that gives us hope for the future, that truly restrains sin by giving us the power to live each day. And that when we find ourselves not quite in that passionate place with You that we once were, we can hear the voice of the Holy Spirit calling us and saying, "Return to Me. Return to Your first love. Return to the One who died for You. Let Me embrace You. Let me hold You. Let Me minister to You." And Lord, we are so thankful that You are a God like that. That You desire us so much. Lord, I know You desire every heart and every life in this place. Including mine. And I pray, Father, today that Your Holy Spirit will move to transform, empower, and renew us. Thereby,